Blink, blink, ding, bling. Ding, 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 ding. Ding, 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 ding.
Welcome.
Oh.
Oh, very nice.
Welcome to Hoya Podcast. Amy. Hello, how are you?
Hello, Jackie. I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm well.
Oh, very good.
I just burped and it tasted like hot dogs.
She had the most shriveled up wieners that I've ever seen.
I love it. I love till they get burnt to a crisp, and then when they cool, they shrink into little hot dog raisins.
That is exactly what they looked like. It was alarming.
Yeah, like a really long raisin.
Oh, God.
Yeah, good.
But she enjoyed them, so, you know, whatever.
I enjoyed them very much.
Anyway, hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Ho Yeah Podcast.
Yes.
Here we are.
We are here.
I told Jackie that I was very nervous about doing this because I haven't done it in a while.
The number, if we had a penny for every time we said that.
I know, every single episode, I'm like, I'm scared.
I haven't done this in a while.
And right before Jackie came over to record, I was like, yeah, come on over. Yeah, I'm all ready. I got everything set up. All of a sudden, I realized, holy shit, I haven't even watched the episode or taken any notes or done anything for this. It just didn't even register that I hadn't done it. And I think part of the reason why is because I've seen this episode so many times because it's a classic and it's one of my favorites.
But that doesn't make sense then. Why wouldn't you remember it?
No, I do remember it, but I needed to take notes. I forgot to watch the episode because I was like, yeah, I saw this very recently.
It's crazy. It's crazy. You can see each episode so many times. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I'm tempted to just like, I'll just wing it.
Right.
But there is no way.
Well, and there's,
you forget everything.
Everything.
Somehow.
I know. And you know, we've said this before. Whenever you're watching the episode with like, I have to record I got to record a podcast about it. You watch it so much more closely than you would have if you just had it on in the background while you're shoveling food into your face.
I have to say, I think the trivia at the end of each episode really amps that up. There are so many times where I'm just like, oh, fuck, I should write that down. I bet it's going to be a trivia question.
Oh, fuck. I guess I should probably pay attention.
Having that quiz every week.
I know. But here we are. We're doing season 5, episode 3.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. For us to be over. You can't say the first part. You can't sing it without continuing.
Oh, if you just go into a restaurant and just sing, I don't want to wait, and then stop there, someone's going to fill it in.
We should do that sometime.
Okay.
No.
I don't want to wait.
So this is a really good one. It's very teen angsty. There's a lot of emotions. There's violence. There's... I hate to say sex, but they're sexy.
They're sexy.
Sexy.
There's so much angst.
So much angst. It is a plethora of emotions, as we all go through at this age. And later on, we'll talk about it. But I'm curious about how you felt around this age, Jackie.
Oh, my God. I mean,
the rage.
At so many points while I was rewatching this episode, I just out loud said, ew. Oh. I just feel so disgusted and angry. And I feel like that's just because that age is so awful.
Yeah.
It's, and uncomfortable.
It's bringing you right back to that place where you did not like.
So uncomfortable.
All right. But before we get into the episode, shout outs.
I'll go first then.
Yeah, I guess. Whatever.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I have another shout out from iTunes. Thank you so much for rating and reviewing mm-hmm. 5 stars. It is so helpful.
Yes.
Because of the algorithm.
We have no idea how it works, but it means something.
We need more of whatever it wants.
We have to feed it.
So 5 stars. The more stars, the more satiated it is. Yeah. So it's an iTunes review, and it is from This is Alexi, or Alexi. And the subject says, love it. And the body says, love this dangle podcast, dangle yip. These two ladies are great, and it's seriously like they'd be my two best friends. We would.
Yep.
I'm sure we would.
Yep.
King of the Hill is one of my go-to background shows, and it's so cool to listen to other women rave about it and laugh at how goofy it can be sometimes. I haven't fully caught up yet because I'm a slow podcast listener in general, but I'm getting there. You will get there.
Yep.
I'm glad you two are together physically now.
Aww.
That's so sweet of you.
I know.
I'm glad too. Glad you two are together physically now, and how we got to see that progression in real time.
Oh.
Anyway, keep it up. Me and my t-shirt will listen when we can.
Whoa, you bought a shirt.
Thank you. This is Alexi.
Wow, you bought a shirt and you left us an iTunes review. Holy shit. You're doing the look. Thank you, babe. Thank you so much.
Oh my God.
Wow.
That's really nice. Thank you, Alexi. This is Alexi.
Thank you so much. Okay. My turn.
People are so nice.
I know. God damn it. All right, here we go. So this is from, I'm also doing an iTunes review because we have to feed the beast.
The beast.
The beast.
The beast.
The beast. This is from Don't Call Me Casey. And the subject says, I have a sense of humor. I laugh at Tony Danza.
I laugh at Tony Danza.
Okay. And then the body. I discovered this podcast a few months after its release and fell in love. Unfortunately, my life had a busy schedule, so I was lucky when I got to listen. Flash forward to a month ago, I took a night auditing job where I could finish 2 to 3 episodes a night.
Ooh, night auditing.
Wow. These ladies have me laughing out loud until I'm in tears.
Oh.
I am sad to say, as an adult, I do not have any friends, and they make me feel like I'm having girl bonding time while also talking about one of my all-time favorite shows. Thank you for an amazing podcast. I was waiting until I was completely caught up to become a Patreon, and proud to say that's happening this week.
Oh,
I look forward to seeing this podcast continue to grow as it has. Oh, yeah.
Oh my God.
I know. I have goosebumps.
That's so nice.
So, a couple of things. 2 to 3 episodes a night. That's incredible. Thank you for doing that. Also, you are our friend.
Oh, man.
For sure.
Yeah.
You absolutely are. And now that you're a part of the Patreon, we do live watch parties the second Thursday of every month. And everybody's friends there. And we all chat. And we have a great time. And I know for a fact that at least some of our listeners who are on our Facebook page, they're all friends now too. So please reach out to those people and talk to them, because you've got like-minded people who would love to hang out with you.
Absolutely. And it's so hard to make friends. I've moved a lot, and a lot of times I used to do that thing where I would go onto Craigslist, and it was just like, you know, friend seeking friend, like platonic. And
oh my God, how are you alive?
I always put a tracker on when I
smart
go and make Will track it. But I like, without fail, you always get porn to those.
Absolutely.
I did end up making one friend briefly. She was like kind of cool, like a little bit weird, but she used to live with a person I knew from our hometown in Florida. How crazy is that?
What?
And I met her in Oregon.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, maybe do like Bumble now, because I think Craigslist is just strictly anonymous sex, which is fine if you want to do that. No, Bumble's supposed to be like, oh, well, I'm from Trump. It's less anonymous.
They need an app.
Let me just say, it's less anonymous than Craigslist.
They need an app that is called Just Friends. Or Friend Zone.
Friends only, and I really mean it, appstore.com.
Get into the Friend Zone.
That's all
and
I want.
Like, and the icon is a picture of like your grandma, so no one can get horny or anything.
But you know that it'll be overrun by people who are just flashing their genitalia.
Oh, they'd love it. These nerds just wanting friends.
They just want friends, and they're going to see my cock, and, yeah. and then I'm going to get off on knowing that they saw my cock and they got mad at me for it.
Oh, you know what you should do? Email them back and be like, joke's on you, I'm blind. And then they're like, no! How's she going to see my cock?
That's right. It read it to me, and then I said, no.
No.
Anyway, all of that to say...
It's hard to make friends as an adult.
It's really hard to make friends as an adult. But we're so happy that you're our friend. And please join us for the watch party.
Oh my God. Gosh. Is it too late to like request people wear costumes to the watch party?
No, do it right now.
Please wear costumes please. To the watch party.
And I will post about it on our Patreon because people might be skipping this.
We did that last year and it was so much fun. Did I wear anything? I'm pretty sure you did.
I was probably a cat.
I was a serial killer. I was a
That's right. You were.
Oh, so
I was a cat. I remember now.
You looked so good. So bring your costumes if you feel like it. Whatever.
Yeah, it's October. It's the month of All Hallows Eve.
That's right.
So please do. Real quick, everybody. We had a little snafu with our email, hello@hoyapod.com. So if you sent us something within like the last month or two, just to be on the safe side, please resend it. And I'm specifically talking to someone who sent us an email. It was absolutely incredible. It was a wild ride from start to finish.
I only got to hear about it. I would love to read it.
And I was holding on to it so I could read it to Jackie, like in person, so I could see her reaction because it's amazing. And it is from someone who specifically mentioned As Old as the Hills and The Decline and Fall of Peggy Hill. Mm. So if that rings a bell to you, because I don't want to go into the full details about your story just yet. So please, please resend it to us because it's an absolutely incredible story and I need Jackie to hear it and we need to talk about it because it is amazing.
Oh my God. And if anyone else has some kind of crazy harrowing story, send that in.
Yes, absolutely. Please do. hello@hoyapod.com.
Maybe for Thanksgiving we should do listener stories of all near-death experiences.
Ooh. Okay.
Okay.
I'm done with that.
Send those in.
Send those in. Okay. All right. You ready?
Yes.
Okay. Season 5.
Wait.
Oh, God damn it. God damn it.
I bet everyone thought I forgot, and I didn't. I bet everyone thought I forgot.
They all forgot.
No, they didn't.
That's right. Their memories are long.
Of course. They're like elephants. Every week for the month of October, I am giving some fun facts about Greg Daniels. And boy, do I have some fun facts today.
Okay. All right.
Well, last week's episode, I mentioned that Greg Daniels was born in New York City, but then I found another website that said, no, he was born in West Hollywood, California. So I can't speak to that.
Oh, so maybe you're a liar.
So maybe I'm a liar because other people are lying. But let me ask you this.
Birds of a feather, Jackie.
Are you calling me a liar or Greg Daniels?
No, I'm calling you a liar.
And who's the bird of a feather?
You and the other liars who said that they don't know where he lives.
That's how liars are born, spreading lies. Amy, do you know what Greg Daniels' middle name is?
Jancy.
Martin.
No!
Yes!
Oh, so that's where the Martin and Wesley, Martin and Archer.
My thoughts exactly.
Well, well, well.
Okay.
That is a fun fact.
There you go.
It's probably a lie because we know she's a liar now.
Wait a second. I forgot the fact I just gave you.
His middle name is Martin.
I believe that. Greg Daniels' horoscope or his zodiac sign is Gemini. And okay,
just kidding.
Okay, this is just going to turn into us hating Greg Daniels. According to this one website, the ruling planet of Gemini is Mercury, therefore, lucky days or whatever, blah blah blah. Scarlet and red are Greg Daniels' lucky colors. Typical positive character traits of Gemini include spontaneity, brazenness, action-oriented, and openness. negative character traits could be impatience, impetuousness, foolhardiness, selfishness, and jealousy.
You know who else is a Gemini? Your husband. My husband. That's why I said, ugh.
Shut up.
Just kidding. I love Will.
No, but I think they might be insane. I don't even believe in it, but they might be insane. Okay, the last thing. No crazier than fucking Leo.
Well, yeah.
Is that a thing?
Well, probably.
They love
attention.
Who doesn't?
I know, true.
Every sign, every horoscope is just a way to make somebody feel insecure.
Good.
That's it. Good, great. Anyway, last fact, if you could even call it this, on a random website called VipBlack or something, it asks the question, is Greg Daniels hot or not?
Oh.
And it had people vote on it. And the results came up, 0% think that Greg Daniels is hot and 100% voted not hot.
I don't know if we should keep this.
Just leave that on the Patreon.
That'll be only for the Patreon.
It's just what I read.
Now I gotta see a picture. I don't even know what this bitch looks like.
It looks like just a regular white
man. Oh, he's just a regular dude. Come on.
Come on. Leave that regular white man alone.
Oh, they face so much.
I know. It's actually harder to be a white man. Harder than anyone else.
He's cute in a nerdy way.
Yeah.
I'd fuck him.
I wouldn't say not 100% not hot.
Right.
He has all of his eyes. Even eyebrow. Looks like he has all of his teeth. Maybe.
100% not hot is a little harsh.
I mean, his vision's not great because he has to wear glasses.
But that's like the nerd appeal, right?
I suppose. He could have broader shoulders. If he wore shoulder pads, he would be perfect.
Can I please start?
I'm finished. So that's your Greg Daniels act of the week.
Okay. Anyway, air date. You done?
Yeah.
Okay. Air date, November 12, 2000, season 5, episode 3. Thank you. Thank you. Bobby's 13th birthday is approaching, and for some reason, he's forced to go to Arizona to his grandma's house for his birthday.
I do wonder how that transpired.
How did that happen? But they were just like, get out. You're going to Arizona. So he's not really jazzed about this. He's like, grandma always thinks that I'm like a little baby boy, and she treats me like a little baby. Wah, wah.
She really does.
And she does. He's right. But how cool is it that he got to fly in a plane by himself at like 12 years old?
Yeah, a lot of us that have like separated parents are used to that.
Okay, see, I don't know.
I started doing it like when I was in elementary school, and the flight attendant would have to walk me from like my dad to the plane.
That's so small.
Well, within like a year, I was taller than anyone that walked me. So my dad was like, is this necessary?
You pulled a Joseph.
Yeah, I pulled a Joseph.
All right. So Bobby heads to Arizona, and Tilly immediately starts to just be like, oh, hey, little sugary little teeny baby boy.
She's singing like what? Row, row, row your boat or something?
Something like that.
Or
like,
Hickory Dickory Dock. You know,
kissing his feetsies and like, happy baby time.
Oh my God.
So Bobby is resenting this. He gets like Tilly gives him this present right away.
Oh.
She's like, I can't keep a secret. I gotta give you this present. And it's Tilly and Gary and Bobby.
Gary.
Oh, anyway, God bless you.
God bless
you. God bless you.
So glad.
So he gets this present from Tilly and he's like, it's a sheriff's costume and it's 8 years old and up. And Gary kind of comes, he realizes what Bobby's like inferring here. He's like, okay. He's like, hey, Tilly, he's a grown man now. He doesn't want to play cops and robbers anymore. You know, what is he, 9? 10 years old. Bobby's like, I'm turning 13. And Gary says, well, you know, in my religion, that's when a man comes of age. That's when he is, or when a boy comes of age, now he's a man. And, you know, he really, like, goes heavy with Bobby on this. He's like, why don't you take my bachelor pad? It's yours now for the week that you're here. You can do whatever you want in here. Also, don't forget, you got a golf cart with your name on it, buddy.
Oh, so cool.
So cool.
So cool. And it's a big golf cart.
Yeah. And Bobby is, he's living it up in that retirement community in Arizona. He smashes into several golf carts and then finally manages to pull out. And he stops some people and he's just like, hey, I'm having a little shindig at my place tomorrow night. Why don't you bring you and your sexy little wife on over?
She can bring some sexy little potato salad.
And this is a keys in the bowl situation, if you know what I'm talking about.
What? Does he say that?
No!
No!
No.
My God.
Bobby's not trying to swing with them.
He could if he wanted to.
He could. That guy, he has swag the whole time that he's there. Mm-hmm. They don't even question, like, why is this child asking me to come over to a party? They're just like, great, what can I bring?
We'll be there.
We will be there. So Bobby's living it up. And he even talks to Gary. He's just like, yeah, this is my girlfriend. You know, she has her period.
Unbelievable.
I know. And he's like, oh, and that's my friend Joseph. But he doesn't turn 13 for another couple of months. So I'm the more matilar one of all of us. Mm-hmm. Bobby's on the plane. He gets this amazing present from Gary. And aww, what do you think it is? A beautiful pen set.
Oh. He's real fancy.
He's a man now. Mm-hmm. Bobby's a man now. And he comes back and he gets picked up by Peggy and Hank, and he's in the back seat reading the newspaper.
Yep.
Just
so sophisticated.
Flicking through it like, oh, the arts section. What's playing at the Arlen Theater this weekend?
Yeah.
So Bobby's reading through the paper and Hank.
Does he even say something like, I like Joseph. He's a good kid.
Yes, absolutely. They're just like, we're going to, you know, Joseph gets back from camp today. So we're all going to meet and go to Rattlesnakes, I think. And Bobby's just like, you know, I like Joseph. He's a good kid.
He's a good kid.
He says, I'm thinking about taking him under my wing, just like Gary did with me.
That's right.
So Bobby has these whole plan, like this whole idea in his head that he's 45 years old, really more like 60. Like he's in retirement age. So when they get to Rattlesnakes, everybody gets out of the car. Dale pushes the seat forward to let Joseph out, and he is towering above Bobby. He's grown immensely in this short amount of time that they have not been together. He's huge. He's huge.
He's a different person completely. He's like physically different. Mm-hmm. He's voiced by a different person now. Mm-hmm. No more Brittany Murphy.
No more Brittany Murphy.
Just like that.
Yep.
It's Brecken
Meyer.
Broseph Meyer.
Brecken
Broseph. Brecken Beth Meyer.
Who the fuck's name is Brecken anyway?
He's got to be. If he's not from California, then I don't know what the fuck his parents were doing.
Exactly.
Brecken. We'll name him Brecken.
So Joseph has transformed into a new person.
It is jarring.
It is. And everybody is like, whoa, look at you. You're so big. He's such a big boy.
How's the air up there?
I know. What was the weather like up there? You play basketball? All that kind of shit.
Oh, basketball.
Ugh. So they're all sitting at dinner together. Bobby's like whole world has been shattered. He was feeling like a man. He was feeling like, you know, I'm hot shit. Cock of the walk. I've got a beautiful pen set.
I had my own place for a while.
Right. I drove a golf cart.
Yeah.
Did you do that at kids camp? I don't think you did.
No, of course not. You kid.
And it has all been shattered with just one upward movement of Joseph standing up.
Oh, yeah.
So they're all at dinner And the server comes around and she's like, all right, here's a bunch of menus for you. And she gives everybody all the adults, like an adult menu, and even gives one to Joseph, and then immediately gives Bobby like the kids menu.
She's so obnoxious about it.
There's so much insult to injury happening mm-hmm. here. Like, Bobby's really getting it ground in that he still looks like he's a child.
Oh my God.
So
he's like,
go ahead.
He's like, I need an adult menu.
Right.
And Hank's just like, Bobby, just order off of the kids menu while you still can.
Which will be forever, apparently, in this show.
Yeah. And, what is it? So he's annoyed about that. And mm-hmm. then meanwhile, like, on top of that, everyone orders beer. Yes. And then this lady asks Joseph if she's like, sir, would you like a beer as well?
Which is insane. Like, have you never seen a teenager before in your entire life? There's no way that this kid looks like he can order a beer.
I would never ask somebody who was 21. I'd be like, you're still too, like, hairless. There's no way.
Come on. So exactly. She asked him, like, sir, would you like a beer? And then she calls Bobby, son, what would you like? And, you know, he's so dejected. He feels like shit.
Yeah.
So Bobby's still, like, trying to recover from this episode of being emasculated.
Yeah.
Pretty soundly.
Yeah.
And there's this really great scene where he's in the kitchen and he's, like, surrounded by fruit pie wrappers. Like, like, as if he's just, like, crushed empty cans of beer around him. He's just, like, fucking pissed and depressed.
Oh, my God, I missed that.
He's got them all around him. He's in the kitchen. He looks so mad. And Peggy comes in, and she's like, how's my little birthday man?
Yeah.
He's like, and she's like, you notice I said man. And he said, you also said little. So, you know, you can tell he's still upset about this. Like, he's right back to the beginning where Tilly thinks that he's a child. His mom calls him little. Joseph is gigantic. You know, he's not hitting like the puberty markers that everybody wants to hit until you get it. And then you're like, oh, this sucks.
It's a bummer for him though, too, because I feel like maybe he's had a little bit of a puberty chip on his shoulder or mm-hmm. a coming of age chip on his shoulder. At least since the episode where they all went hunting and
right.
he couldn't go.
Right.
So, I don't know. He comes off so confident, though.
Yeah.
But I could see this being a little bit of an insecurity, and he finally felt validated being with Gary, having his own place and own car. It's hard to go back to hosting your own geriatric parties at your place.
Right.
To having to eat off the kids' menu.
I know. So he's still kind of getting over this, but he still goes over to talk to Joseph, and he goes over at least twice. The first time he goes over, he's like, hey, you know, let's go try out party subs. So let's go get some tasters, which sounds awesome.
Yeah. I'd love to go tasting sandwiches with you.
Are you kidding?
Yes.
I got to go tasting cakes one time for a wedding, and it was the best experience ever.
Why don't we just do that all the time?
Oh, and I got to taste like the caterer's food for the wedding. I was like, I'm getting a full-on meal for fucking free.
Yeah, why don't we just always do tastings?
That's a really good idea. We're going to start doing that.
Okay.
So Joseph's like rolling up a sleeping bag. Like he's like preparing all this camping gear, because I guess that's what men do. And Bobby comes over. He's like, we're going to like go test out some party subs. You know, you got to come with me. And Joseph's just like, no, I don't have time. I have to stow things. Like I have to put things away. And Bobby's just like, well, what the hell, man? I'm inviting you. If you want to be a part of this party, you have to come with me. And Joseph's just like, fuck off, man. I don't want to do this. So Bobby takes off. And then he goes and talks to Connie about it, and he's brought some of the party sub tasting tastings with him. And he says, sister, you know, just like, I don't understand what's going on. Like, you know, he doesn't want to hang out with me. He doesn't want to taste subs with me. And Connie says something along the lines like, well, you're just not there yet, Bobby, which is another huge insult to him. you know. And
I feel like Connie's made comments like this before, like, you don't get it, or like, you're not there. It's like, she's a little bit
of an a-hole about it.
A little bit of an a-hole sometimes. She is.
She is. There's no doubt about it. But, you know, and he's just like, oh, excuse me. I am in downtown there, baby.
Yeah. You're not there yet. I'm in downtown there. I love that.
I know. I am living it up in puberty town.
I'm the mayor of there.
That's right. So, once again, Bobby's just, he's being rejected by Joseph. He feels kind of like a loser with Connie, her saying that, like, he's dating this person, and she's just like, you just don't fucking get it. Like, you don't even, like, you're just like a baby.
How could you speak for how somebody else feels, Connie?
Right. Anyway, so Bobby still tries again. He goes back over to Joseph's house, and Joseph is, like, trying to fix his bike, make it a million inches taller. And Bobby comes over, and he's like, hey, I have your, you know, your invite to my party. And Joseph's like, no, I'm not going to go to your party. And Bobby's just like, he's like, what the fuck are you talking about, man? Like, this is my party. Like, you have to go there. You're supposed to be my best friend. What's going on? And for a quick second there, it kind of seems like maybe Joseph is laughing, but then
it's like he's shaking.
His shoulders are like going up and down, like a ha ha ha.
Yeah,
but it's more just like
yeah. You just hear like it could be laughing or crying.
God, stop it. So Bobby's just like, hey, you. Fucking fuck. What are you laughing at? What's so funny, Mr. 5'10" I'm assuming?
With armpit hair, probably.
Yeah, oh, that's it. That's where he's just like, with armpit hair, I assume.
I'm sure.
So, finally, like, and then Joseph turns over and he's crying. Mm. And Bobby, you know, he's just like, whoa, wait a second, what's going on? Instead of being like, oh, I gotta go.
Yeah.
He's just like, what's happening? What's going on? And Joseph is just like, he just lets loose. He's like, I got stretch marks on my shoulder. Oh. I got acne on my back, which at 33 years old, same.
It doesn't go away.
It doesn't go away. And he's just like, I can't dance. I can't even ride my bike. And my dad keeps asking me, how's the weather up there? Bobby's just like, well, tell him that it's fair with, like, a side chance of stupid, something like that. And
fair to partly stupid.
That's it. That's it. So good. And Joseph's like, damn, that's good. That's why you have a girlfriend. Stop thinking about girls.
Ew. This is definitely one of my ew.
I felt that way too, but then I was also like, I also couldn't stop thinking about boys at that age.
I remember being terrified of penises.
Well, of course. I didn't know what they even looked like.
I couldn't imagine that. Yeah, I wasn't totally sure what they looked like. Just like a stack of tires or something.
I thought,
but then it has to go inside
jelly
you.
Things.
Oh, those like, jelly things that look like buttholes on both sides?
Yes, and it's got like the plastic bits in it, and you squeeze it.
And it
like,
shoots right out of your hand.
I mean, really, that is what they look like.
I feel like those things are kind of like training.
I know, it's so fucked up.
It's messed up.
Anyway, I mean, I was boy crazy, so I kind of get it, but I wasn't like, that's all I could think about.
I can't imagine if I had like a penis. I feel like people with penises like have it a little bit harder in the horny department sometimes. I don't know either.
And
I might be thinking of just like the fact that you can't necessarily control boners.
Exactly.
That's
what a
terrifying.
Nightmare.
Yeah. I think that's what I'm thinking of. Just, that's rough.
I know. You can't control your bone. I mean, come on. And a lot of the times it's just involuntary. They're just like, well, I guess they got a boner now for no reason.
I'm sure like half of them are just fear boners. How scary.
God. And in middle school. And when people are just relentless.
Oh, they will find it. They want so bad to find something.
They want.
Here we go, down to middle school.
They want to see your boner and make fun of you for it.
Oh, they want, even if nothing happens, they'll be like, ew, you, and your body's gross.
Very true. Anyway, so Joseph is struggling and he's just like, I don't even have a girlfriend. I want a girl so bad. Oh. And Bobby's just like, all right, look. listen, I'm pretty good with the ladies. Okay. I know how to wine and dine. And Charisse is coming. I know you got a thing for her. And maybe she has a thing for you. I'm not saying that she does, but maybe we can like figure something out.
She didn't seem totally grossed out when I told her you were coming. That's a positive. She's still willing to come. So
she said, I will still be there. Yeah. So they have like a little bit of a, oh, yay. Okay. So now we're on some even ground. We understand what's going on. Where each person is. Yes. Each person is coming from. Oh my God. I've completely neglected the B plot with Hank building the coffin.
Oh, well, tell us about it now. It's great. So another wonderful B plot.
It's so good. Hank gets an itch to start building coffins.
That's right.
And the first one he makes is utter trash.
I'm surprised at Hank.
I know.
Making such a shitty coffin doesn't even close all the way.
Doesn't even close all the way.
That doesn't seem in character.
Well, the next one that he makes is like primo.
Stunning.
It's stunning.
Yeah.
I would die in that.
Yes, I would live in that.
I would be buried in that.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Gorgeous.
It's like a pillow, a fancy pillow for a fancy tiny dog in coffin form.
Exactly. So he starts off building this one coffin and it sucks ass. And he's just like, hey, Peggy, I built you a coffin. And she looks at it and she's like, you've got me fucked up. Yeah. If you think that I'm going to spend eternity in this hunk of shit. Who do you think I am? I will haunt your ass until the day you die. And
my ghost will haunt you. I will make sure of it.
Ghost of Peggy Hill will haunt you. I love that. Yeah. So then he continues on building more coffins, at least one more coffin. He builds a really nice one.
Beautiful.
For Peggy and a nice one for him. And we get to the night of the party and Peggy's feeling kind of sad because she's like, I've always brought in the cake. I've always been there for Bobby's birthdays and he doesn't want me around. Which honestly, I think that if I was a parent, I'd be like, thank God we finally have reached this point.
Not Peggy.
Like, good. Do whatever you want. I don't give a shit.
Leave Every me alone. Second of this kid's childhood is the last second she'll ever have. She's not going to have another kid.
You're right.
So she's just like, what? You don't want me to present your cake at your 13th birthday party? I like took a class on rapping. So why wouldn't you want me to do that?
I know how to DJ now. Like that is the most embarrassing thing your mom could ever do at your 13th birthday party.
Unimaginable. Unimaginable.
I can't even imagine. Anyway, so Peggy is just, she's feeling dejected. She goes out into the garage. She's like, Hank, I've done this all the time. And he's like, hey, fuck Bobby.
Yeah.
Check out this sick ass coffin I made for you. And I ordered a pizza and I'm getting fucked up on beer. So why don't you join me?
Lovely. Hank is killing it in this episode. Love him.
So hot. They're so hot. They even use the old really shitty coffin as like a beer trough.
That's right.
They fill it with ice and all types of beer and booze. And I'm like, this is the hottest thing I've ever seen.
So cool.
So the party's happening and Bobby is schmoozing. He is feeling himself and he's inviting girls in. He's like, hey, you just took my breath away. And they're like, oh, Bobby. Oh, silly. And he's like, hey, you see my new and improved friend, Joseph. And Joseph's really awkward and like he can't manage his body or his limbs right. You know, like it's he's grown too fast in too short of a period of time. He can't adjust to his new body.
You're so right. He does not know how to be in it.
No, he doesn't. It's just there's too many limbs happening here.
Oh my God.
Too much limb.
So real.
So he's just awkward. He's uncomfortable. Finally, Bobby's just like, come on, Joseph, get on out here. Let's dance. We got some Christina Aguilera. Mm-hmm. This song is top of the charts in this time period.
2000.
Yeah. Let's blast it. Get on out here and let's dance.
Genie in a bottle.
Genie in a bottle. Well, so good.
It's been out for a few years by this point, truly.
I don't know.
Yeah.
So, and Joseph, he's like a little awkward at first, and then he really starts getting into it. And he's like rolling his fists around and he ends up fucking punching Charisse in her face. Her glasses fly off of her. She's like, oh shit. And he's like, oh my God, I'm so sorry. And he kneels down, he bends down, he picks up the glasses. And instead of just standing up and giving them to her, he just lingers on her legs for a long time.
Fear boner.
Fear boner. And And she's just like, what are you looking at, you fucking creep? And she just pushes him face first backwards. And he's like, oh my God. And everybody's laughing at him like, haha, you fucking creep. And he does this like, he does this like really crazy crawl away, a very Dale crawl. Like, I could see Dale skittering away from something.
Scrambling away. And it's another, I feel like we've seen this animation before where it's a scene where one person is towering over another and you, like, are just looking up at Charisse as she's looking down at you slash Joseph. And it's terrifying, really terrifying.
Yeah. And she's like, get out of here, you fuck.
All she needs is to have a third boob and to have all three of them rotate. Remember that dream sequence?
Yes, absolutely. Or my daddy's having a heart attack. One of the two.
Terrifying.
And it would be a nightmare scene. Anyway, so Joseph is just, you know, he skitters off and Bobby comes running after him and he's like, what are you doing? I totally set you up with Charisse. Like, come on. And just like, I don't know how to fucking talk to girls. This is weird. I don't know what I'm doing. And he's like, listen, I'll show you how it's done, buddy. So he brings Joseph and Connie into his bedroom and he has a VIP sub. That's how he tempted Connie into his bedroom by being like, here's your VIP slice.
VIP area is cool.
I would be like, oh, okay. Yeah. Is that turkey?
Characters?
I'll be there. Right. Maybe an Italian?
And nobody else is in there? Okay.
Okay. So Bobby's like really going heavy with Connie, just being like, oh, your hands are so soft. Like, what are you doing,
it
girl?
It's
so awkward.
Bobby is like doing great up until this point. I mean, he's like being a really good friend to Joseph and, you know, he's charming in his own way, like being like a grown up in Arizona. Oh, but this is so nasty.
This is where it gets pretty bad. So, you know, and Kaiser's like, well, I'm using a new soap. And he's like, you must be using it on your face because it's so smooth. And she's like, what are you talking about? I have horrible acne right now. Like, I'm breaking out. And it just like continues to this point where finally Bobby's just like, women, am I right? She must be on her period.
Oh my God. Well, he's just like, I don't think I've kissed you today.
Oh, that's right. How could I forget the most important part?
What did he say? Like, I don't think I've kissed you today. Like, let's fix that or something. Yeah. And he's putting on like such a production while Joseph is open mouth eating his VIP sandwich, just staring at them. Just like, nom, 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 nom.
Open mouth eating his VIP sandwich.
Eyes as open as possible, staring straight. Not even like trying to like look down and then corner eye it to be discreet. Just staring right at Bobby as he puts the moves on. And Bobby's not discreet at all. He's just like, let me kiss you. And he might as well just turn to Joseph and be like, watch this. And then poor Connie's just like, wow, this is disgusting. You're disgusting. I'm definitely leaving. This is so upsetting and gross and offensive. And then Bobby's just like, she's on her period, probably.
Imagine. Fuck you. And she's just like, excuse the shit out of me. I'm out of here. Bye.
Oh, my God.
So she takes off. She goes back home. So Joseph goes over to Connie's house to apologize. And, you know, he knocks on the door. Good con moment.
Oh, thank God for con.
Jolly Gribble Giant. So he lets him in. And, you know, Connie's just like, oh, would you come to watch me do my homework? You fucking creep. And he's like, no, I'm sorry. I just want to tell you, it wasn't Bobby's fault. It was my fault. He was just trying to help me out. And she's just like, well, whatever. It's still not fine. It's still not okay. And he's like, all right, well, I'm sorry. I gotta go. And he like turns around and he smashes his head on her lamp. And he's like, oh, fuck. Fucking idiot. And she's just like, I don't think you're an idiot. And like, he turns around and they look at each other and
their faces look so funny as they're staring at
just
each other.
Like, ha, 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 open mouth staring at each other.
They both look a little bit like frogs, but it's very sweet.
It is. And so they start to kiss.
Oh,
they start kissing and as they're kissing, Bobby's coming over. He's going to Connie's window and he's rehearsing a non-rehearsed apology. Okay. And he's brought a piece of cake and he turns and he sees illuminated in the light them kissing, and he loses it. He throws his body at the window, forces himself into the room, and he's just like, what the fuck are you two doing? That's my woman! Just, he loses it. He's so fucking mad. He straight up punches Joseph.
Twice.
Twice. He does it once right off the bat. No warning. Joseph's like, ow, shit, that hurt. And he's just like, I would do it again if my hand didn't hurt so bad. And then he's like, fuck it. And just punches him again. And they're just like, what's happening? What's going on? And they're all arguing. And Joseph, like, Min comes in and sees that Joseph got his ass kicked. He got punched by Bobby.
He's got a bloody nose.
And she's like, oh, shit, come here. I'll take care of you.
And she laughs at him. I love him.
I love Min. She's incredible in this. Mm-hmm. Like, we get such a small snippet. And she's so good. And so, you know, Bobby and Connie are arguing with each other, and he's just like, he's full on losing it. Like, he has no cool. His face is contorted. Like, he just looks so rageful. And he's like, fuck you, I'm breaking up with you. We're done. And he leaves. And then we cut to Min taking care of Joseph, and she's just like, how did tall, dark, and handsome get beat up by that podunk guy? So she's like, Joseph is automatically just like, ooh, she's into me.
A woman.
Oh, a woman called me handsome. Oh, she's into me.
But she's like cleaning up my face and leaning over slightly so I could see just a little bit down her shirt. So
right. And she bent over the counter so I can see her bottom.
She likes me.
Right. And she's cleaning his face and he just like starts kissing her and she just pushes him away and starts laughing, which I love that. Cause I think I'd be like, what?
I'm so glad. And he says something like, I thought you liked me.
And then she starts crying. She's like, oh my God, Khan is going to get a kick out of this, which I love. I've said it before. I love the relationship. I love that she could like go to him and be like, guess what? He tried to make out with me. And he would be like, ah.
Yeah. I have like, I want to predict that season 5 will be the season of excellent B plots and Min.
Oh, please, God, yes.
I'm going to keep my eyes out for that.
Absolutely. So Joseph takes off running again, and he's falling. He's tripping all over the place. He cannot get his feet underneath him. He's like a newborn, like, gazelle. Yeah. He cannot handle it.
Can't coordinate.
Cannot. He's tripping everywhere. He falls down in front of the Hill garage, and he looks over, and they just both rise out of their coffins.
Hank and Peggy.
Yeah, and he just, oh, shit! He screams, he runs off home, and he gets home, and Dale's just like, hey, how's the weather up there? And he's like, that's it, I'm done. And we also see Bobby is super pissed. He's back at the party, he's sitting on a chair, and Connie comes back over, and she's like, hey, I wanted to apologize and make out with tongues.
Yeah, she is in the wrong now. There's so much back and forth in this episode. It's hard to keep up. But yeah, like Bobby was the asshole before. Now she's feeling like she's the asshole.
Right.
I'm gonna make out with tongues.
And then very quickly, Bobby becomes the asshole again. Because she's just like, I'm sorry. And he's like, I don't know where your tongue has been. Which, shut up. And then she says something. I was like, I didn't mean to. He was just so sad and tall, which I think that was the trigger for Bobby saying that he was tall. And Bobby's like, oh, and you're so loose and cheap, which, excuse the fuck out of me. Where did you even get those kind of words?
It's crazy that like that is Bobby's instinct to be mean.
Right. You wouldn't. I mean, he really. The only thing that I will say for him is that he is immediately regretful of what he said. Immediately. It's not okay. But I will say that it didn't take him long to realize, oh shit, I fucked up. And instead of being like really doubling down and being like, yeah, I said what I said. What?
Whatever. Sorry.
Whatever.
Yeah.
You know, he was just like, oh shit, that was too far. That's the only thing I will say for him in that moment, because he was an asshole.
It's hard to control your feelings when you're that age and you're heartbroken.
Right.
It is extremely nasty.
That was nasty. So she takes off running. She's like, oh my God, that was so mean. So she takes off running and she like runs into Joseph, who's stolen the bugabago. And she's like, it's the most dramatic. Where are you going?
Wind is blowing.
And he says, I'm going as far as an eighth of a tank of gas will get me. And he's so just like, I'm leaving this joint.
Yeah.
I'm leaving this town. You coming with?
I'm taking this bugabago as far as the sky. I'm out of here.
I don't need your rules. I don't need my dad. I'm gone.
And she's hanging off the side of the truck. And she's like, take me. Wind blowing in her hair.
Take me with you. And so she gets in the car. And then Bobby comes running out. Where are you going with my woman? That's the most dramatic shit. And she's like, I'm not your property.
Oh, my God.
And so they're all in the bugabago. And Bobby's like, I came to say sorry and do tongues. And she's like, ew, get the fuck out of here. And they're all arguing and fighting. And so, and of course, because I think Joseph has never driven.
He can't even walk.
He doesn't even know what he's doing. Slams the bugabago right into a telephone pole.
Mm.
And they all just kind of are like, what? Run! Just like fucking take off running. And I forgot to mention this, but Dale has some amazing parts in this.
Really good parts.
There are so many good Dale parts. But he comes up, he's like, oh god,
oh god,
oh god,
oh god,
oh god,
no, 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 no.
And they're just like, he's like, who did this? You, to some old lady.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And he's like, come on, man. You know it wasn't her. Like, there was probably somebody else.
He's always targeting frail old people.
I know. Come on. You,
I love it.
God. So finally, you know, they're just like, hey, you kids were probably around this area. Did you see anybody? And Bobby just kind of looks at the two of them. And at first you think he's going to rat them out, but he's just like, I don't know. I think maybe it was teenagers. It was probably teenagers. And they're all like, yeah, it was probably teenagers. Dale's like, damn teenagers. So they get off a little bit kind of scot-free, even though they look incredibly guilty.
Everyone's satisfied by that answer.
Right.
Oh, teens.
Oh,
okay.
Oh, yeah, that makes sense.
Never mind.
Probably was. And then we get Peggy.
Oh.
Best ending. It's just like, happy birthday, bitch. Here's your cake. And she's just like, that's right. 13 for 13.
I got to present you with your cake 13 years in a row. You didn't think I'd get that 13. I'm going to
it. And then she starts here, she's like, that's right. I'm Peggy. Put your leggy. Get funky with it. And then everybody claps. Well, that was very good.
Standing in front of Dale's busted truck under a telephone pole.
God.
Light applause.
Light applause. And I will end this episode with some applause, because this is a very good one.
It really is.
Okay, we want to take a little hot minute here to do a shout out.
This episode of Oh Yeah Podcast is brought to you by some very jazzy cats. But my heart is saying yes, yes. If you want to be with us, Jesse H. But my heart is saying
hello, Joe V. Welcome.
Am I Jenny? So used to getting my own fucking face. I'm a genie and a bottle, baby. Come. And Bobby, sobby.
My heart is saying, let's go, Tim T.
If you wanna be on our Patreon, then this is the price to pay.
You gotta give me five doll hairs. You gotta rub me the right way.
Doll hairs. Come on in.
Come on in. That's it. We're done.
I can't wait to hear the music. Don't even try to sync it up at all. It's so impossible.
Bad. I might not even put any music to it. Just leave it like that. Jackie.
Yes.
Give me your favorites, your likes, your, I guess.
Well, these are a few of my favorite parts.
Ooh. I like that.
Thank you. Well, the first thing I wrote down was Gary.
Gary!
With an exclamation point.
Yes!
Gary!
Gary!
And I know that something potentially bad happens to him, but I'm too afraid to ask what, and I can't remember. And I'm also kind of hoping it doesn't happen. I'm not ruling that out, but I'm nervous. So when I saw him, I got excited. I also got a little scared.
Yeah.
But he made it through the episode, so we still got Gary.
We still got Gary.
That's right. Oh, I wrote down this part when Bobby's talking to Connie. He's in her room. He brought his test sandwiches.
His test sub. I love it. I wish. Okay.
And he's complaining about Joseph, and you know, he doesn't like ride bikes or do anything cool anymore, and he's so stupid and tall and gross. And Connie, who is, you know, pubed herself,
maturing, if you will,
you know, says, well, you know, there are some days of the month when I don't like to ride bikes, Bobby. And he's like, oh, are you talking about your period? And she's like, well, yeah, I was trying not to say period. And then I like this part because Bobby just kind of puts his hands up and he's like, why? It's a natural, beautiful thing. Whatever whatever Peggy told him, I think she did a great job.
It stuck.
Yeah, it stuck. And she must have explained it in an awesome way for him to just be like, it's a natural, beautiful thing.
Because beautiful, I would not use as somebody who has periods. I would not say it's beautiful. I would say that it's pretty fucking rough.
I guess like on a certain level, it's like it could represent like renewal or something, or like giving life, but like
a metaphysical level,
the day to day of it. But bottom line is periods are gross, but I'm not opposed to beautiful being a description.
Agreed.
A loose description.
The last thing I feel is beautiful, but I will accept if somebody else says that without me bleeding out.
Very much so.
Shitting my pants.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's my dream. You're right. I am beautiful as I shit my pants. Clear up that work bathroom.
The next time you're having horrible diarrhea, I want you to sit up straight, stare straight ahead and say, I am beautiful.
Take a deep breath.
Mm-hmm.
Drink it in.
Drink it in. Savor the feeling.
I am powerful. That's what you say to yourself.
I love, you know, I was surprised by this episode. I went into it fully thinking like, here's where I start hating Joseph. I remember like showering this morning and I hadn't watched the episode yet. And I was just thinking, why would they do this? Why would they take Joseph away from us? This is not fair.
Right.
I'm not ready for this, Joseph. It's gross and I hate it. Why would they do this? But so I went in with a real sour attitude and outlook, but I ended up not being as bothered by Joseph this episode. And I will say I'm perfectly willing to admit that my hatred of Joseph is like got to be at least like 80% projection of how much I hated myself when I was his age.
I would just let's wait until a couple of episodes in where he's fully pubed out, but I get exactly what you're saying.
His personality
with this episode, yeah. Yes, I get what you're saying.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, that's right. Wait. I'm sure I will be taking all that back. But it's such a weird age. Just the way they animated him, like the way he moves, the way he like looks, everything he does is so looks painful. Existing looks so painful.
Yeah.
Emotionally, cognitively, and physically.
All of it.
And it really is what it's like, and it's kind of a miracle that you don't realize how shitty that period of time is until you're an adult and you don't feel like that, like you're, you know, trying to figure out how to puke. And it's such a relief compared to that you're like, oh man, what an awful time.
What an awful time.
Oh, so uncomfortable.
Yeah, I know. You know, I agree with you. I also really had a soft spot. I had a soft spot for Joseph in this episode. Like, yeah, he was kind of creepy, but he was mainly just really torn apart. Like, he didn't know what he was doing. He grew too fast in too short of an amount of time, and he couldn't control his body, his hormones,
his voice, nothing.
He was off the charts on all levels.
Oh,
you gotta feel bad for somebody. You gotta feel bad, because that's shitty.
I can't imagine like what it's like to not be able to control a boner. It'd be like if one of our boobs just like stuck out like sideways for no reason. There's nothing you can do. It's so embarrassing. And it's not even like it's like your knee. It's your like boner.
It's right there.
It's like, look at me, everyone. Look at my dick. Unfair. So yeah, I'm definitely, I found myself having more empathy for Joseph. And if anything, I was much more annoyed with Bob in this episode.
I knew you would be. I know. Well,
of course.
I know.
You should be that prick.
I know. You know, I always have to. All right, whatever. Okay, continue.
Well, he's a prick.
I know.
But I don't know. It felt like I was watching this episode for the first time, because I watched it years ago and I always kind of avoided it because I think it was like too soon in some ways. But also it broke my, I just remember feeling heartbroken for Bobby when his best friend and his girlfriend right away in that bugabago.
Yeah.
I just thought like, oh, I could never handle that. It would be so upsetting. And now watching it years later as an adult, I think I was like a little bit more pissed at Bobby. So I didn't feel too heartbroken for him, but it wasn't as cut and dry as like my friends left me for each other. It was just everyone was pubing out.
They were
in their own like dramatic notebook movie, and it's very dramatic.
Notebook movie. Very, very true. Very true.
Yeah. It was extreme. But so I feel like I have a new perspective on this episode, and I like it a lot. Although I did have a lot of moments where I was just like, ew. I like Khan's jolly gribble giant comment.
So good.
I like when Bobby tries using Connie to teach Joseph about hitting on women and scoring. And she storms out. She storms out of Bobby's bedroom. It's just Bobby and Joseph. And then Bobby's closet opens and Dooley walks out with a girl. He was in the closet the whole time, and he's just like, Joseph likes to watch.
What the fuck was Dooley doing in there with that poor girl?
He was making out.
Ew!
I would love to see Dooley hit on someone.
Right.
You're hot.
Yeah.
You're dumb.
Yeah, you're right. It would be something mean.
I like when Bobby is heading over to apologize to Connie before he sees Connie and Joseph kissing, and he's carrying his cake, and he's just rehearsing this apology. The apology's just something like, Connie, I rehearsed an apology, but I threw that out and I'm speaking from the heart now. But he just keeps saying that over and over.
No, nothing says I'm sorry like, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
And he's repeating it over and over again.
He does a good job of like, I get close to like feeling sorry for him, and then he'll just be a little bit of a douche, like him rehearsing that apology and trying to act like it's not rehearsed. And then when he's chasing after them in the bugabago and he's just like, that's my woman, I'm like, ah, oh, fuck you. But I think those were pretty much all of my notes. I just wrote one of my, oh no, no, that's not true. One of the notes I wrote about Peggy was just, oh no, when she rapped.
That's my favorite Peggy part. It's so bad.
The last thing I wrote down was just, Amy, have you ever been to a bar mitzvah or a bat mitzvah?
I have not.
Me neither.
Yeah, no, I guess.
When I was growing up in New Jersey, so many of the kids I went to school with in elementary school were Jewish, and I had like so many bar mitzvahs like ahead of me. I was so excited. And then I moved like when I was like almost 12. So I just missed them. But man, I wish I could have gone to a bar mitzvah.
Son of a bitch.
Yeah. If anyone has one, please invite us.
Please God invite us. I would love to go.
Oh, hell yeah.
So those are excellent points, Jackie. Very good.
Yeah.
Very good. My turn. Okay. Let me scroll on down.
Oh, every time, every episode, there's going to be
this. It's got to be the little beep. Like, are you there? Are you paying attention to something you shouldn't be?
But it's in like our last 10 episodes. I need to like, just take the watch off when I record.
All right. So I've got a few things. I wrote down a lot because, you know, I haven't watched this, and that's not true. I watched this episode recently on a watch party, and we all laughed, haha, and I think that's why I thought that I had already watched it.
Oh, yeah. That's usually whenever I have that deja vu feeling, I was like, this must be from a watch
party. It had to have been from that, but I really love this episode. And again, you know, I don't know what it is, but like, I love the episode with, and they call it Bobby Love. Ooh, anything that's like really teen angsty.
Oof.
I just love it because I remember how fucking shitty that time was. And it's so easy to forget that as an adult. Like, it's so easy to be like, you piece of shit, Bobby. How dare you call her loose and cheap? Which, yes, how dare you? But also, like, you're also like 13 and you're a fucking idiot and you're angry because you can't control anything. I don't know. I just feel like
it's true. You've never felt these emotions before, so you have no idea how to navigate.
You have no clue. And like Connie kissing Joseph. Yeah, for sure. I could get that. There was a very tender moment between them. Joseph like eating shit all the time because he's grown too much. He doesn't know how to use his body. And like he steals his dad's car, which because he's mad. He's ready to get on out of here. I love a teen angst. It's so good. But anyway, so I did take a lot of notes, but I'm going to try and power through them. Love Hank in this episode.
Yeah, Hank is great.
Hank is great. We just, I don't know when we're going to get to another episode where I don't like him because I'm just always turned on by him. Anyway, so when Bill comes up to me, he's like, hey, what are you building? And Hank says, oh, a coffin. He's like, coffin? And Hank says, I was talking to a client the other day about forest fires, and I can't remember exactly how the conversation turned to coffins, but hell, long story short, I got the bug.
I got the bug.
I got the bug. I got
the bug.
I got to make a coffin.
Oh, my God.
Got to see how we do this.
I would be freaked out if I, like, the idea of building a coffin sounds fun, but then once I have it, I'm scared of it.
Throw it off a bridge.
Oh, yeah.
Burn it. Burn it immediately.
My body's not going to spend eternity. I can't know where my body's going to spend eternity. I can't know.
In an urn. Burn me up. Fuck it. Coffin?
Shoot me into the sun.
Boil me down into a diamond.
And then what?
Eat it.
Oh. Pass me.
Pass me.
Flush me down the toilet.
We'll be very connected.
I'll go to the ocean.
Goodbye.
Bye.
And then a fish will eat me and I'll kill it. Okay. So Gary Rules one of the things that, like, what, how amazing would that be to be 13, almost 13 years old? You go to your grandma's house and she's babying you, but then this cool older guy who you already like, we already know Bobby likes him from Unbearable Blindness of Laying. And he's just like, hey, I'm going to take him under my wing and you can like chill in my bachelor pad and you can ride my golf cart around, which when you're 13 years old and you can ride a golf cart, you might as well be in a Porsche.
Oh, yeah.
You're just like, look at me. You can't do nothing about it. I'm going to peel on out of here.
This is some big boner shit.
This. I am rock hard.
Yeah.
And I am not going to hide it this time.
I'm never going to be this adult again. Yeah, I would love to have a cool step-grandpa like Gary.
Right? God, like, he rules.
I would love that. Just a best friend who's an old man.
Who, yeah.
We're just best friends.
Right. And more open than Hank is. Like, even when Bobby was like, oh, she has her period. Like, Hank would be like, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
But Gary was just like, meh, whatever.
Yeah.
They go away eventually.
Yeah, give it 15 years, it'll be gone. So relaxed.
Oh, is that all, Gary?
Oh, don't worry. That's just a phase.
She'll get over it.
It's gone before you know it.
again, we get some amazing Dale in this episode.
Yes.
He just says, Count Dracula has thousands of coffins. They say he sleeps in a different coffin every night. I don't know if it's true. It's just what I heard. And then I love Bill. He goes, yep. Sounds true. No, it sounds made
up. No, that sounds made up.
I don't know.
Yeah. He's just too excited to think about it. Well, maybe. Oh, no, but he can't.
Well, I don't know.
I don't know.
Let's see here. I did really enjoy Bobby and Joseph's relationship in this episode. You know, I like how Joseph cried. That was nice to see.
That breakdown.
Yeah, that was nice. And Bobby being supportive of him in that moment and still trying to be supportive, even though they had some sort of like weird rivalry. You know, there was still a lot of love there.
Yeah, it's a shame to see them fighting and having negative moments, because their tender moments are so tender.
They're so tender.
They're so tender.
Just like a butt roast.
Like a nice char grill boiled fried steak.
Char grill boiled fried steak. Delicious.
So tender.
So tender.
They have such tender moments, and they're like just really honest and open with each other. And hearing, like, there are a few moments where Bobby was just like, is that all that is? Well, no worries, we can like figure that out. You're like, you should have just told me that. It's like, oh
yeah, tender. I know, so open.
Yeah,
ready to talk about your feelings. I love it. You don't get that enough.
No,
you don't get that enough. Okay. Oh, a little animation detail that I loved was that Bobby in his party outfit with that beautiful button down, he had his fancy pen in the pocket.
Oh, good eye.
I have never seen it until this rewatching.
Of course he had his pen.
Yes,
very,
because he's a
pen.
Man. This is his manutant, Bob.
Manutant.
This is him. I am a man. And look
here
at my
I
pen.
Am. I present myself.
Look at my pen.
I am a man.
I have a pen in my shirt pocket.
I have a pen in my pocket.
Because I have to write. I have to write checks. I have to write notes.
I have to keep logs
of my day. So love that. Love that little detail. Bobby, when he says to Min that after he punched Joseph in the face, he's like, I took care of business, me and my hammer.
Get the fuck out of here. I could see them like in the writer's room coming up with that line, me and my hammer.
So good. I love, I came to apologize and make out with Tongues.
And they both, when they both say that, Connie and Bobby, they're like, make out with Tongues, and then they both like close their eyes and open their mouths.
Just wide open. Okay, so I'm just going to get, okay, here's my last one. Another really good Dale. When the Bugabago husband crashed, and he just like, faints into Hank's arms.
Yes.
And he goes, what evil hath been wrought to befall this upon me? The drama.
He has so many good lines that makes me think of his, like, what happened to me can only be described as a hate crime. Somebody hates me. He has so many of those good lines.
It's so me. Oh, so that's really pretty much all I got. All right, you know what time it is?
Listener comment time.
That's right. And guess what?
We have a song.
We have a song.
Oh, thank God.
Came to us in the nick of time.
Awesome. Just now?
Well, earlier today.
Perfect.
Close enough.
So close enough.
So close enough. Okay, here we go. And it's from our dear friend Sean R.
Oh, okay. So it's gonna be good. Everyone relax. We don't have to like
feel
tense and nervous.
It's fine. It's gonna be good. So listener comments on Howdy, Amy and Jackie. I hope you've had a great, well-deserved break between seasons. I've missed you both. Here is the third and final song from your trio of listener comment song requests from the infamous Tequila Shots live stream on Insta.
Oh my God, I don't remember.
I have no fucking clue, and that makes me nervous about it. Okay, if you need to ask who's the final artist,
oh,
just call on me, because it's Steve Winwood.
Damn, we picked some good ones.
We did.
Damn, I don't remember that at all.
Love and Punishment Hugs, Sean, a.k.a. Arbitrary and Delicious.
Oh, Love and Punishment Hugs. I'm sad that this is the last one. We'll have to do some more tequila shots and request more songs.
Absolutely. Okay, you ready?
Yes.
Here we go.
Hey, Amy and Jackie. Arbitrary and Delicious, bringing you the third and final of your requests from your tequila shot stories. I hope you like this one as much as you've liked the last two. Keep the requests coming. Get excited. Here comes Ho Yeah Pod. Download on iTunes or early on Patreon. Peggy, gonna make your day. Like you woke up to some poisson paint. Have yourself a ball at the watch party. Trading jokes with my man, Derek Kelly. Amy and Jackie are heaven sent. Send them some love with a listener comment. Play me that Ho Yeah Pod. Play me that Ho Yeah Pod, oh. Play me that Ho Yeah Pod. Where's that listener comment I've been waiting for?
I am sweating. I know. I've never been hotter than this entire time that we've been
recording. Ears and nose and cheeks are all on fire. That was so good.
So good.
Yeah, that was good. Oh, man.
I mean,
I wish I could remember that
that live stream that we did.
A live stream. Yeah.
We could watch it, but I like to keep it in suspense. I don't know.
What we need to know, Sean R. will let us know.
That's right. Thank you so much for that amazing song.
What can I say? I mean, this is the bar, people. Good luck reaching it.
I know. But we encourage you to try. Send us your songs at hello@hoyapod.com.
Yeah, you don't have to be that fancy. People have literally just, like, called in and, I mean, like...
We've had a cat sing it.
Well, that was very impressive.
That was also the bar.
Don't feel like you have to reach that bar either, okay? Whatever you send in will be fine.
We will love it.
Even if it's just you, like, screaming at your cheating ex, we'll play it. All you have to do at the end is be like, listener comments. That's it.
You whore. Listener comments.
Fine. I'll consider it at least.
All right, here we go.
Here we go.
Oh, wow. We got something deep right off the bat from Delirious. Hank and Peggy's coffins represent them mourning the end of Bobby's childhood.
Wow.
At least for Peggy, right? Hank is probably just like, goodbye. That's why he's drinking beer and eating pizza.
Wow. Yeah.
That's deep. That was intelligent. That was a good one.
That was a really good one.
Thank you.
Delirious.
And then they also say, I am upholstering, which is one of the five original industrial arts. But oh, God forbid you sew.
Right.
Women's work.
That's upholstery. Oh, some tribe says, Joseph likes to watch.
Catherine Moore says, Min is the greatest in this episode. Absolutely.
Agreed.
She fucking rules in this. She's so cool and unbothered.
Mm-hmm. Catherine Moore also says, this episode should be called One Tree King of the Hill.
Arbitrary and Delicious says, oh yeah, you rock my world. Fairhead says, I'm Peggy. Put your leggy, get funky.
Nurse in Ember says, in asterisk, Dooley voice,
Amy and Jackie like to watch.
You're right.
_ dangerously says, Bobby is such a dick. You're so loose and cheap. Connie should have kicked his ass.
True.
Agreed.
That was a low blow. And you know what's interesting too is so 5_star_star.man says, I never had a birthday party growing up, so I always hated how ungrateful Bobby was.
You know what? I had like little pangs of that too, because I never had birthday parties really. My mom, she would offer a birthday party or she'd be like, you can spend $200 at Toys R Us. And I'm a kid with ADHD, so instant satisfaction. I'm just like, Toys R Us!
I would have done the same exact thing.
That $200 runs out fast. But I was just thinking kind of similar thoughts. Just like, man, you know, you get to have this awesome birthday party and your parents are staying away. You little turd.
I know. Well, I, you know, the only birthday party I remember from my childhood is the one where nobody showed up at.
What? Nobody showed up.
I haven't told you guys about that.
No.
Yeah. It was like in elementary school and my birthday's in July. So it was like outside of the school time.
Oh, fuck.
And so like
those summer kids always got screwed.
Yeah. And so like two kids showed up and I'm so sad for little baby Amy.
Yes.
I feel so bad for myself.
I'm sad any kid that has.
We had gift bags and cake and probably a party sub.
Did your parents call the other parents and yell at them?
I don't know. Probably not. I know your mom would have, but I don't think my parents did.
Oh my God. Oh.
Kate, my sister, tried to make it really good and like help out because she's got a heart of gold, even though she's nuts.
The most like dependable person.
Absolutely. So poor little baby Amy. Nobody showed up.
I didn't realize summer birthdays were so hard. It's true though.
Because like that was there was no internet, there was no cell phones, there was nothing like that. There was no like Facebook invite to an event. It was just like, all right, well, we sent you guys an invitation back in like May when we were still in school. So hopefully you guys will come. And they didn't.
They should have. Their parents are pricks.
They are. Thank you.
Yeah.
I appreciate that. Poor little baby Amy.
Damn it. And you've like been like making it up by partying nonstop ever since.
Absolutely correct.
And you've succeeded tenfold.
And I have really made up for it. Oh my God. I just had a breakthrough. Thank you. Thank you, Jackie.
You're welcome. You're doing great.
I'm going to go sober now.
Yeah.
Just kidding. No. Oh. God, no. Absolutely not.
Don't stop the party.
No, I without the party. No one. I'm that little 8-year-old Amy.
Don't worry.
Surrounded by gift bags that nobody wants.
You'll have your party.
Okay, sorry. Listener comments.
I'm so glad you shared that, though. That's incredible.
Oh, so sad.
Yeah.
Can you queer me now? Just says, honestly, everything about this episode. Exactly. This whole episode, there's so much to it. This is why King of the Hill is so good. The episodes just, they're chock full of anything you've ever wanted.
Even like the lines they give to Bill and Dale.
Yes.
And like people who are barely in an episode. It's just like, all right, you only have two lines, but they're going to be incredible.
They're going to be so good.
Yeah.
God.
Like those actors came in that week to record and it was just like, oh, just this. And like, it's still like, oh, that was a banger.
Oh, let me knock it out of the park real quick. Just yeah. And please pay me for it.
Yeah.
Thanks.
See you next week.
See you next week. See you next Tuesday.
McPeekaboo0 said, Hank's coffins really inspired me to manage my own funeral affairs while still alive.
Wow.
Wow.
Really?
Wow. That's incredible. Should we manage our own? Maybe we can make it a mini-sode.
That would be a good idea.
Where we manage our affairs.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll leave all my debt to you.
All right. I'm going to wear a silk dress and a feather boa.
To my funeral?
No, to our affairs.
Okay, cool.
I just want to be glamorous while I do it.
I do want you to wear that to my funeral, though.
I leave you my basic-ass middle school Tiffany's bracelet.
I leave you my burnt out vibrator. Not washed.
I leave you My burnt out vibrator with a broken finger. Well, it's really a wing, but one of the wings are broken.
The other one worked like hell.
I favored that wing.
You did.
Yeah. All right. I have one more. I have one more.
Okay.
I'll let you go first.
Okay. Oh, hold on. Car Josie. As a tall person, King of the Hill fails to show that the tall jokes will continue well into adult life.
Yep.
I mean, I don't know. I'm pretty tall, but I don't really get a lot of tall jokes. Do you?
I don't. It could be. I feel like by the time you're a grown up woman, maybe not as much as men still get it.
Yeah, because Will's very tall. So does he still get like a lot of tall comments?
Yeah. People are always just like, so you're an expert at basketball, yes? And he's like, no, I have no idea. I'm bad at it. But that's like the number one questions.
I know. My dad has met Will so many times, but he doesn't remember any of the times. And every time he's always just like, who let this tall guy in here? I don't like this. Why is this guy so tall? What's going on here? I'm like, Dad, calm down. You're still very strong. It's fine.
I used to be self-conscious about being tall, and then I remember being in a public restroom and washing my hands, and the girl next to me was taller than me, and it freaked me out so much. I was not used to it.
Yeah,
and
no,
I thought, like,
why would you be?
I need to run away from this situation. All right, and my last comment is by KDMC44, and it says, "Chicken wingdings or choo choo chicken fingers."
Oh, that's part of my trivia question.
Oh,
whoopsie doozle. Did she say what the answer is?
No.
Okay, good, because that's my question. Right. So put it down. Put it down. I don't want. I spit all over
it's
you.
Okay.
Sorry.
I'm covered in your spit, but I don't care. I honestly don't care.
Okay. Sorry.
I don't care.
Here we go. Trivia.
Trivia.
I do spit a lot, don't I?
It's cute.
It's all over the place.
No, you don't.
Yes, I do. No, you don't. Okay. You want to go first?
No.
Okay, because you're still trying to figure out what your trivia is.
Well, I screenshotted them, so I'm looking. I found one.
Got it. All right. Okay, so I'm going to
go first. But I choose not to.
No, get out of here. Who does Bobby invite to his party at the retirement home? What couple? What's their last name?
The Johnsons.
You know, that would have been that's a great guess. The O'Connors.
Oh, damn.
Very, very close to that. Very generic. Okay. What is the difference between butter beans and lima beans?
Oh. Well, I know they're a different color. One makes you toot more.
They're the same bean.
Shut up.
They're the same bean.
No, they're not.
Yes, because Peggy comes out and she's like, Hank, do you want butter beans or do you want lima beans? And I thought, what's the difference between those two? And then I looked them up and I'm like, they're the same fucking thing.
Wait a second.
I know. You know what? Please prove me wrong.
Well, it's just, I have to reckon with this in my own mind. Butter.
I feel like butter beans is a very southern thing.
You think it's just a regional versus lima beans, right?
Right.
Oh, Lord. Don't tell me this. They are the same thing.
They're the same thing. I was blown away too.
Who I don't know why that freaks me out.
I know. Well, butter beans sound so much more delicious than lima beans.
Trick question. Trick right. question.
That's all right. And I've got more, baby.
All right, go ahead. Right.
I've got one more. What does Bobby order? Chicken wingdings or the choo-choo chicken fingers?
Choo-choo.
That's right.
Ooh, it's
very
more
childish.
It is. He just leaned into it.
It's way more childish. All right. Very good. That's all of my trivias.
Okay. I have two, I believe. Yes.
I'm ready.
Okay. Amy.
Yes.
What building number? What's the number of Killy's building and living space?
I knew it. I knew it because that was going to be one of my trivias, but I didn't go back to get it. So I have no fucking clue.
All right. Well, give me one number and one letter.
69.
Ooh.
F. Oh.
That would have been awesome if that was the answer.
That would have been really cool.
It was building 42, living space K.
Goodness gracious.
Oh, boy.
I just saw spit fly out.
Okay.
It's all over the place.
I am okay with it. Do you want me to spit on you?
Yes. Right in my mouth.
Those are little windshield wipers on Amy's eyeballs. Okay. Good luck with this.
Oh, she even gave me a snarl.
Oh. Amy.
Yes.
Gary lends his golf cart to Bobby, and he's just like, go take your big dick for a big dick swim.
Right.
That's stupid.
No, that is great.
He's like, take my golf cart. And he tosses the keys to Bobby. There is a key ring, like a tag on the keys. What does it say?
You know, I know this one because I saw it in my little rereading. It said, fun fact.
Okay.
Senior discount.
No,
fuck you. That is right. That's right.
You're missing one word. It's three words.
Fuck. Senior discount bonanza.
No.
And I was so confident.
What is it? My heart is racing.
No, I was so confident.
You were extremely close. I am flabbergasted. And it says, senior citizen discount.
Oh, get the fuck out of here.
It was so hard to read on this stupid little thing.
Damn, that was a good one. I am sweating.
I am so sweaty. And
that's it.
I have one more.
I've blown my load on this episode. I gotta take a nap.
I agree. We have to go to bed.
Yes.
Amy.
Mm-hmm.
One of the five original industrial arts is upholstery. Name the other four.
God damn it. I also thought about looking this up, but I didn't have enough time. Welding. Iron smithing.
Smithing. All smithing.
Smithing.
That's one. Hey.
Including welding in the smithing. Okay.
It's
industrial arts.
All metallurgy and smithing.
Okay.
That's one.
So let's also say like arts. Okay. I was going to say like coal mining, but that's not an art.
It's not an art.
The art is not dying.
The art is not dying.
That's the art of it. To live forever. Okay, darning, metallurgy, cooking.
Nope.
I don't know. I have no clue.
So on this list, one is woodworking. Woodworking.
Oh, of course.
And all other carpentry and joinery.
Uh-huh.
Two is masonry and all other stonecraft and pottery. Three is upholstery and all other needlecraft.
Mm-hmm.
Four is metallurgy and all other smithing, up to and ceasing with the Renaissance.
Very important.
Five is glassmaking.
Oh, wow. Okay, well, that all makes sense.
I can't believe that Hank knew that. That's very cool.
Aw. Well, because he would love to be able to call anything other than sewing.
And maybe he maybe he learned that when he was teaching.
He was like in a home ed class. I bet he was in a home ed class and they're like, we're going to sew a pillow. And he was like, I will darn a pillow.
Upholster a pillow.
I will upholster a pillow. Okay. That's it. We're done.
That's it.
That's it. We got to get out of here. We got to go. Time for bed.
We're so sweaty.
I'm dying.
I'm so sweaty. Well, and do you know what the next episode is?
No. No.
I don't either.
Okay. Here we go.
Let's see. Joseph is gross now and he's tall. God, I hope it's not another Joseph episode.
I don't think it is. Season 5, episode 4, episode. Spin the choice.
Oh!
It's a Thanksgiving episode. Have we done this? No, we haven't. We did Happy Hanksgiving.
Oh my God. Should we save this for Thanksgiving?
I think we might. So we'll see you next week.
Rate and review on iTunes. Please send us your Halloween stories.
Please.
Funny, spooky, sexy, fanfic, fake, whatever.
Send us something. We love you.
We love you. And until next time.
Vaya con Dios.
Open up your morning light. Sing a little bell. Gonna try not to stay alone. See a piece of memory.
What a crazy time of year. There's nothing like this now.
Thank God. This would not slap now.
No. She has her babies.
She had two babies. The one best and one was three. In the world of 44. Every time for me.
Okay.
Sorry.
What is this song about?